Half a sheep covering.
The arts of the Etheria. The Etheria.
Rock and roll. We're in Richmond. And so you can see the date on here, 1795. That would be Lachlan Macquarie right there in what would be a kind of cartouche figuration. And among other things here with the fire and water kind of around the floor, if you will, here, we'll just have a look at a few things. We'll be going over to the rotunda, which is right here. And there is a little fountain we'll check out just right in center of screen right there. And just for a moment, we will go to this configuration just through here. That's the end of one of the train lines here in Sydney with the train station right here. And just proceeding through this way, we have a classic configuration here of the four around the one. And we'll just take a look at this photo from across the street. So, one, two, three, four, and the one in the center. Now, we have an aspect to each of these outer participants. Sacrifice, courage, endurance, and on this one, mateship. So each of these has an imbued quality. Within this section of the Bible here, it talks about the lamp of the body. So we're talking about the light body, I would suggest. What else? We have the single eye referenced in here, which is obviously the Ajna chakra, the third eye. So here we can see the reference to fire. So we're talking about a candle, flame, fire. There's yet another one within this verse, within verses here that talk about the light body. Are we getting it? So your further bodies beyond your physical body, the light bodies, this is talking about that body being one of those bodies, being imbued with light. So it actually appears as fire. And this symbolism is just shown over and over and over again. Yet people would generally not have a clue. But anyway, so within here, sure, the light of the body is thine eye in there. Therefore, thine eye be single, bloody blah, blah, blah. And here we have the reference to lightness and darkness, blah, 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 blah. So down here it goes, if thy whole body therefore be full of light, having no part dark, the whole shall be full of light, as when the bright shining of a candle doth give thee light. So it's comparing, it's sort of bringing the candle, the flame, into the light body, if you will. It's the way this is worded. The candle and put it into the secret place. And within the Bible, there are further verses that go on about the candle, the menorah, and the flowers of it, and all the rest of it. It's just dealing with the chakra system.
Now, in the ritual situation, you can have the participant in the center, on the pedestal in this case, with the pedestals around the outside as well. But the obelisks would represent light, and I would suggest that the participant could be here or an outer orb, an outer structure also. But this is perhaps built off the light structure of the person or a further entity also assisting with that light structure of, in this case, the obelisk structure. So you have the four around the one, and I can show, as I've shown many times before, the configuration of the four around the one and the energies going into the center. In the center, you see the classic three steps out of Freemasonry for the mage in the center. Now these would perhaps be etheric steps with the light body being elevated on the top here. Within the detail, you can see the ubiquitous swirls, which I would suggest are representative of etheric light, etheric matter. And on that note of etheric matter, we will certainly see that, especially as we go over to the rotunda, which is just across through here.
Okay, so we were just over here with the configuration here, and remember how I talked about that you could have the participants where those obelisks are, and even in the center. And in fact, we'll flash to a picture now where you can sort of see that configuration. And indeed, yeah, they do this with the cataphalic situation and all the rest of it. But so we have this little monument here, this little fountain with the interestingly enough, the levels on it. And down here, also you have the checkered floor in a way, with the, in this case, the six sides here and the three, but you have the checkered floor with the water there in a way, with the central pillar of foliage in the center, and that's your foliage right there. And then emerging out of that central pillar are these three cherubim in this case, and you can see the foliage on the cherubim right there very clearly. If you look to the Starbucks logo and you look to further, I can show further images regarding this, you will see this around. So they, we'll just have a walk around here and you can see yet another configuration of that. And walking around further. Now these levels go up, and in this case you have the central participant, the mage in the center as part of the central pillar right there, and you can see that the water is flowing through it. That is an etheric pillar, I would suggest, with a flow of energy sort of rather than water, although the water is the thing, the sort of physical thing that we use to depict the etheric nature of what's going on here within this fountain. So from here we're going to now go across to the rotunda, which sits right through here. Okay, so once again, that's our obelisk situation over there. The fountain would be over in this direction over here. And this is the rotunda here, an octagonal rotunda. Now, this rotunda has a bit of detail in it, and this is what I want to show. And to me, it's quite, well, very fascinating, because to me, this shows what could be a depiction of the etheric flow going into the center here. Now, it's got netting around it because obviously birds would get in there and nest on it and all the rest of it. Something we've just noticed is that these, and if I look inside one here, you've got lighting in here also pointing up here. So this would be like an etheric light structure, I would suggest, up here. And you have the lighting, and at night this perhaps senses people coming in here, and there's a lighting situation in here. So you can see the branches of etheric flow. Now, what a, you know, I've never seen a rotunda like this, but if you were to sort of ask me about it, I would have sort of said this anyway, because to me the configuration of the rotunda, these would be the participants around the rotunda like this. And here you have the central configuration here of what I would suggest is an etheric flow. Now, another way to look at this is that it could be the roots of a tree also. The central pillar, and here you have the plate in the center. So the roots of the tree, it could be also, but that etheric flow going into the center. And I can, particularly from the thief, you can see this, but there would be other situations as well where this flow kind of in and out of the center, these rivers, if you will, these rivers of etheric flow.
These rivers of etheric flow.
Okay, so changing tact here and just diverting a little bit, we're just going to talk about the procession here. This is from Charles Ledbetter. I'm basically going to read through here. As I'm reading through, you may think of circumambulation, and you may think of Mecca and the circumambulation there, and everyone pointing in that direction, heading in that direction. It's magic ritual-esque, if you will. But nonetheless, we will read here. So, everywhere on the surface of the Earth, there are great magnetic currents passing both ways between the poles of the Earth and the equator, and others coming at right angles to them round the Earth. The co-Masonic procession of entry into the lodge makes use of these currents, forming of the space which we circumambulate a distinct eddy or specialized magnetized portion of space. To look into this a little further, on the Wikipedia page for circumambulation, you have reference there to Hinduism, Christianity, Islam, of course, Judaism, Zen Buddhism, Sikhism, Baha'i, Bon, and Freemasonry. So within all of these religions, practices, call them what you will, you have this notion of circumambulation there somewhere. So here's a picture just regarding the entered apprentice doing a circumambulation of the altar in the center in this case. So, and this would be the same for the stupas also in Buddhism, and I've talked about the stupas as once again it's a and you can see there between the pillars of Jachin and Boaz in this case here, but it would represent a structure of light, I would suggest. Now with Islam, the Muslims would do a circumambulation counterclockwise seven times, so those seven times would surely relate to the seven chakras. If we go to Cirque du Soleil for a moment, we can see the mage throwing the elemental orbs out from the base chakra, four in this case, and you have four petals on the base chakra. Now, as they go out and then go back into the mage, that raises him up through into a various dimension. His awareness grows. And then when he throws the next lot out, there would be more than four, as per the guest to my channel, The Modern Shaman, and you'd have to go back through my old videos to look at that. But anyway, so he would go up through the chakras, and in a way, this would what would be kind of represented at Mecca and these places also. Yes, I know there's a cube there and all that sort of stuff, Saturn and all the rest of it, but there's this aspect as well, the Mount Meru, it all kind of ties in. The raising up through the awareness on this tarot card here, you can see the kind of mountain, if you will, Mount Meru, that central pillar, that is you. You can see the chakras on there represented clearly, and you can see the four rivers coming out, and you can see that mage also kind of throwing those orbs out also, the four rivers. It all kind of ties in different ways of representing the magic ritual happenings that that various people in secretive societies go through on this earth. Just looking at this Bible passage for a moment, if you really stop and read this, you can see that it kind of alludes, I would suggest, to the secret societal part to our society here on earth. Yes, but anyway. Okay, so we've already looked at the notion of the procession, as Ledbetter has written, and you have the earth's currents going in a crisscross pattern, if you will, in a way across the tessellated floor, the Masonic checkered floor. But and also you would have the entered apprentice or the person within the ritual creating an eddy within that etherically magnetized space, so creating the space. We'll go on now to further writings from Ledbetter. Now, the setting in this writing here is in Egypt, so just note that as I'll bring Egypt up. But anyway, we'll just go through this for a moment, and just reading here, we'll go above the blue. So the Masons, the Brethren, are on the floor there, and they should be thinking of the words of the intro-sessional hymn and canticle, and taking care that the procession is well done and in good order. But in addition, they should be deliberately directing their thoughts to the magnetization of the mosaic pavement and the space above it. So indeed, it's the three-dimensional space, but they are now creating an interdimensional space also, an etherically magnetized interdimensional space onto which further entities can come into, etc. But also, there is etheric matter within this space. And of course, within the ritual, as they go up within the chakras, they get a recognition of what is in the space, if you will, via comprehension, via the third eye, and raising up through the chakras and having an awareness, an inner awareness of what is in that space. So in ancient Egypt, it was considered to be the duty of the right worshipful master to direct the currents and form the eddy in them so as to magnetize very strongly the floor round which he passed. So they are etherically magnetizing the space, the ritual space. We'll now read further. The floor has now, rushing across it, magnetic currents or lines of force, like the warp and woof of a piece of cloth. Just for a moment, let's look at this piece of Masonic artwork as I've read that, and I'll just read that again. Magnetic currents or lines of force, like the warp and woof of a piece of cloth. And this forms the foundation upon which we build the great thought form, which is one of the objects of our Masonic meeting. In view of the enormous value of the thought form made on the floor of the lodge, we can see how important it is that none should disturb or confuse the currents by walking in the wrong direction, or bringing into the lodge thoughts of ordinary business, the cares and worries and conflicts of the world of daily life. So within the ritual edifice, all of that wants to be left behind. And since Egypt was brought up, in this depiction here, you can see what is perhaps the throwing of etheric orbs in this case, a form of etheric flow. And on the notion of etheric flow, from Cirque du Soleil, you will notice here, if you look carefully, that the orbs are drawn from the base chakra. Now, this was mentioned by the modern shaman, but that's another thing to look at. And then further within RuneScape here, you can see the same thing where they are drawing from the region of the base chakra. This time the hands are going round to the rear and the etheric energies are being directed into the center, an etheric flow in this case. From World of Warcraft, we have Fury of the Sunwell, and in this case also you can see the energies being directed into the center. This is all no coincidence. In this shot of a vase I took from the Masonic Center in Melbourne in the museum there, you can see the mage on the floor with the etheric matter on the floor. I would deeply suggest you have the comparison of one section of the floor with the tessellated floor, the checkers, and then you have that etheric looking aspect as well. So whilst we're in Melbourne, outside the Masonic Center of Victoria, which is in Melbourne, you have these very porous pillars right there. Now, are they trying to tell us something, the Masons, about a non-physical nature to the pillars and to structures in general, I would suggest? But within this artwork, we have pillars of light and sound, according to the artist right there. Very interesting. And you'll also notice sort of formation in there too if you look. As I was walking down a street in Melbourne, I looked up and noticed this, what is quite a lonesome little etheric swirl, I would suggest, on the building. This sculpture has an angel atop it with the etheric flow, I would suggest, pouring down the sculpture. It sits in the middle of the street with the rivers of etheric flow. And on that note, now this would be the same thing we saw the swirls earlier. This would relate to that phenomenon as well, I would suggest. We're here in Richmond. This is St. Andrew's in Richmond. And just for a moment here, we have yet another obelisk here in the church grounds. They've gone and put the foliage there, but I'll just speak to a moment for the foliage around. We'll go through the archway here, through Jachin and Boaz in a way, and often you will see the foliage on the doors, the foliage right through the church, on the pews and all the rest of it. But here on the archway, you have the foliage here, as if it's coming down in this case, or in this case with the pillar coming up. But Charles Leadbeater, for one, talks about the building angels in the ritual situation constructing an edifice out of light and dropping the leaves of a banyan tree from above in the lodge situation down. And this is in this case with this particular aspect here, and you will see it in many other places, would be a representation in stone of the presentations of light that are actually made by further entities from the further spirit world.
Now, I'd just like to make a disclaimer here in that I'm not saying it's a fact. I'm going off the writings of both Furs Morrish and Charles Leadbetter regarding the building angel staff. Although I'm putting up images from Freemasonry and elsewhere, if possible, regarding things that I think kind of back up these notions. Now, as I was ad-libbing in front of the church there, and I mentioned the downwards, dropping downwards of leaves, well, in the actual quote, it's got roots. So they drop, this would be the building angels, they drop supporting columns from above downwards like the roots of a banyan tree. And it's interesting in this alchemical drawing, I think you can, I think it alludes to that. But beyond that, when we go back and look within the rotunda, that kind of looks a bit root-ish as well, if you will, as well as etheric, if you will, I would suggest also. But hey, I'll leave it at that. I hope you enjoyed the video. I hope you got something out of this video. Please think, please read. Bye for now.